today, it's a very interesting interaction and interesting topic. The current pregnancy laws, all of us in our practice come across such patients almost every second, third day. And whether how to take a detailed history, what points to be taken in a history, how the trick of inferring or coming to a diagnosis on the basis of history only, her obstetric history, her menstrual history, the family history, her detailed personal medical history, what points you need to keep in mind while you're examining her, because the idea is to come to a diagnosis or come to know the cause of her repeated pregnancy loss. All this and much more we will be discussing today. And for most of all, I welcome our Dr. Sharda Jain ma'am, our most beloved teacher of teachers. I request ma'am to say a few words and then we begin. Sharda ma'am.
I think it's a great pleasure to that, you know, the talk is being by Dr. Kuldeep Jain. Kuldeep Jain is a known IVF expert. His center is known all over Delhi and in Northern India. He's a great laparoscopic surgeon. And IFS, I remember from the beginning, you know, collecting the memorandum for it and to the present stage, I think he is the person behind it. And he has been beside anybody who has been a solen person as far as the IFS is concerned. On infertility front, I don't have to really say anything about him. He's there in all the national and international bodies. And his presence in FOCSI has been there for a long time on a various aspect of infertility. He's contesting this time for a vice president post of FOCSI. And we all wish that knowing his credentials, he is a great candidate for the same and requires your choice. And as far as the topic he has chosen for today is recurrent abortion, which is a very dear subject to me. And I think I have all come with a very open mind and take something, a few points from his talk. So over to you, Dr. Kuldeep Jain. And my sincere wishes to you is in this election, which you're fighting for FOCSI, that you should come with the bright colors. Dr. Kuldeep Jain.
Thank you. Thank you, madam, for your kind words and words of encouragement. I think they mean a lot to me. And I am really happy to be here on my my home forum. I really wish that I am involved more and more in the activity. Of course, I am having a lot of things at present in my hand, but I certainly will like to be doing much more for this forum, for which I have been a very integral part since beginning. So thank you very much for your kind words and wishes. And I hope that I will get love, affection and support from all of you. As far as the topic of today is concerned, recurrent pregnancy loss is a topic, actually it is having a lot of more of gray areas than the solutions. That is the one thing which I will like to highlight throughout my discussion, but whatever I am going to present is basically some of them, they are recommendations, some of them we have been practicing for long, and even the recommendations are not there, still we keep on practicing. So that is one area where we really need proper guidelines, proper recommendation based on the expertise, experience from the previous years of practice, and of course, evidence-based. So until unless we have clear-cut guidelines, this area of recurrent pregnancy loss will remain in the more of in the gray than the green. So as far as the recurrent pregnancy loss is concerned, I have also gone through a lot of literature and found that there is not much consensus as far as the management is concerned. Even amongst the best of the bodies of the throughout the globe. I thank the forum president Dr. Jyoti Agarwal and Dr. Deepti Nav for giving me this opportunity to be speaking today on my home forum. As Dr. Sarada Jain has already highlighted, with her permission, I will again like to seek your vote and support. I have been practicing for last 35 years, and since then I have been the member of active member of FOCSI, worked in various capacities throughout. Ah. Vikrant, can you mute?
Vikrant, please.
Mute everybody. Mute everybody.
Yes, except for sir, please mute.
My last assignment with FOCSI was as a chairperson endometriosis committee, which ended in 2019. And during that time, it was very really fruitful and very productive. So that gave me a little more impetus to work more for all FOCSIans throughout the country. And now I am presenting myself to all of you as your vice president candidate, North Zone. So looking forward to have your vote in my favor from 1st September to 10th September. I request all of you to check your credentials in FOCSI website or in database that your name is correctly written there or not. Because only A grade members, A category members will be eligible for voting. So please check from the FOCSI website, and this last date for checking is 25th July. Coming on to the topic of today, that is recurrent pregnancy loss. What I am going to discuss today is under these heads in next 25 minutes. What is recurrent pregnancy loss? Because there has been change in the definition. What are various risk factors for the recurrent pregnancy loss? What are recommended investigations? What are the treatment options available to us? What is the evidence for various treatment and options? And what is the, where should we go for future research to help these patients to get a live baby home? Now coming on to what is recurrent pregnancy failure. This is from ESRAE guidelines 2017, recurrent miscarriage defined as the loss of two or more consecutive pregnancy. Previously, it was three or more consecutive pregnancy, but now it is changed to two or more consecutive pregnancy. So this is one change which we need to remember. So once a patient loses her pregnancy twice, then we should start investigating. It usually affects 1% of the couple, but when you are dealing high-risk group, it may increase, like in infertile segment, it may increase to 5 to 8% of all infertile couples. So that is the difference when you are dealing with general population and infertile couples. And out of that, usually 2% are second trimester pregnancies. Most of them, they are first trimester miscarriage. Coming on to the risk factor of recurrent miscarriage, if you see, this is a very nice presentation, and I will like to focus on this area. And this is, that's why recurrent pregnancy loss remains a gray area, because in 40 to 50% of the cases, 40 to 50% of the cases, the cause is not known. So it is very huge amount when you see the recurrent pregnancy loss, and rest of them, they are 15 to 20% is hormonal infections, because we always keep on looking for the infection, and it is not that high, 0.5 to 5% only. Then there is 15 to 20% which are because of autoimmune or blood clotting factors. Then there are 10 to 15% which are anatomic. And again, genetic is also supposed to be, because we keep on looking for the genetic causes, it is not more than 5%. So if you remember this chart, then you can focus on the investigations where you have to look for the cause of your recurrent pregnancy loss. Apart from these, there are other risk factors also which we have to keep in mind. Like if the lady is smoking, it is a high risk factor for the pregnancy loss. Then alcohol consumption is also actually these two things are very nicely highlighted in current ASHRAE guidelines that you have to look for history of smoking, exposure, number of years, for how long she is smoking, and same is with alcohol. Another thing, what I was talking for the infertility, endometriosis, adenomyosis, they are all high risk factor for recurrent pregnancy loss. Obesity is actually supposed to be an independent risk factor. So if you are having a very high BMI, you are likely to lose a pregnancy more and more. Then of course, increased maternal age is again an independent risk factor. So whatever, even if there is no other risk, if the lady is conceiving at the older age, then it increases. And here you can see between 35 to 39 years, there is 20% risk. And after 40, it becomes 40%. So it is again age related. Then of course, there are multiple other factors which may cause. Thyroid disease is another factor which is supposed to be a very, very important risk factor for recurrent pregnancy loss. There has been actually concept of recurrent miscarriage clinic. In India, it has not picked up yet, but I believe that there are many high-risk obstetric unit which are having a separate recurrent miscarriage clinic. And I think this is again very nicely highlighted in current guidelines that all these patients, they should be referred to recurrent miscarriage clinic, which is dedicated. They are to be looked after by a health professional which is having necessary skills and expertise. This is another thing which is nicely highlighted in the current document, that written patient leaflet to be given to all couples, giving all information so they can take a informed decision on their pregnancy. Now, coming on to the investigations, this is another part which is having a lot of gray areas. When it comes to the recurrent pregnancy loss, we always see the prescriptions. Some prescriptions will be having a full profile of investigation, which may be not be necessary in that particular patient. And some of the patients, they do not get investigated properly. So I think whenever we are having a case of recurrent pregnancy loss, this is the list which needs to be completed. There are few things which are in query bracket. So we will discuss them little more. Diabetes needs to be ruled out. Thyroid needs to be ruled out. And then general condition of the patient needs to be evaluated by normal blood counts and of course the clotting factors. Then pelvic ultrasound scan is very, very important. A detailed pelvic ultrasound scan, because in the causative factors, if you see, it is 10 to 15% anatomic region, which may lead to your recurrent pregnancy loss. So pelvic ultrasound, including 3D and 4D, are recommended. Hysterosalpingogram to rule out any anatomical defect in the uterus. Hysteroscopy, this I will go into little detail, that all patients who are having recurrent early pregnancy loss, I think they need to be investigated for presence of any anatomical problem which can be corrected in these patients. Serum baseline hormonal investigation, there is a query whether it is required for recurrent pregnancy loss or not. This is only for those patients who are suspected cases of PCOS and obesity. There it is recommended. EPLA profile, when we talk of EPLA profile for immunological factors, it is complete profile, including LAC, anti-cardiolipin antibodies, both IgG, IgM, and beta 2 glycoproteins. So this is the basic profile which all patients should be going through. Apart from this, there are extended investigations in this immunological profile, like activated protein C resistance and deficiency, protein S deficiency, factor 5 leaden and homocysteine. This is again has come into a query in recent guidelines of 2017, whether this should be done or not. It is conditional. So a word conditional has come here when it comes to the extended immunological profile. Parental karyotyping, again, there are a lot of gray areas, which patients should go for parental karyotyping, which should not go. I will go into little detail. And then, of course, high vaginal swab, that is simple investigation, should be done. This is from Greentop guidelines of 2011. And here you can see all women with recurrent first trimester miscarriage, they should be screened before pregnancy for antiphospholipid antibodies. It is not only antiphospholipid antibodies, full profile needs to be done. Is there any difference between the early fetal demise versus early embryonic demise? It has been seen that similar rate of aneuploidy is seen in both of the products, but type of aneuploidy might differ. So when you are having a patient with early embryonic demise, early embryonic demise means there is no fetal pole. That is called early embryonic demise. It has been seen that aneuploidy rate are higher in that group. So otherwise, rest of the things remain same. What about karyotyping of POC? It is recommended in third miscarriage. This is again an older guideline of 2011. But whenever you are sending POCs for karyotyping, you need to remember the limitation. There is maternal tissue contamination. It might fail to grow if it is not collected properly. Abnormal embryonic development reported with normal karyotype. So even if the karyotype is coming normal, the patient may be having, the fetus may be having abnormal embryonic development. So these are some of the important things which, when you are interpreting the karyotype from POCs. What about the parental karyotyping? Again, there's no clear-cut guidelines here. If you consider Greentop guidelines, only if karyotyping of POC reveals unbalanced numerical defects. So they suggest that when in POC there are unbalanced numerical defects, then only you have to go for parental karyotyping. ASRM says in all cases of RPL. And SRA says in couples of high risk of being carriers. So there's a clear-cut difference in the guidelines. But what is our practice? What should be our practice? We need to find out. And unfortunately, we are not having a very clear-cut guidelines as far as the FOXI is concerned. I think we need to work on that. What should be the guidelines for our members to be working on recurrent pregnancy loss? Till then, I think next two or three slides will be able to. Next two or three slides will certainly help in deciding. So when we look at the parental karyotyping, low maternal age at second miscarriage, that is one clinical tip. So all patients who are having a second miscarriage at the younger age, I think they are the right candidate. A history of three or more miscarriages, you can go for the parental karyotyping. Even when the POC is normal, a history of two or more miscarriage in a brother or sister. So if there is a family history of miscarriage, we need to consider parental karyotyping, and a history of two or more miscarriage in the parents of either partner. So whether the brother or sister is having history of miscarriage and or the parents, either parents, whether husband or wife. So these are some of the guidelines or clinical tips for parental karyotyping. Now, what is the consequence of carrier state? If you see normal karyotype in the conceptus, the carrier status of same balanced structural abnormality is there. And when you are having unbalanced structural abnormality, that is only in 1%, the chances of having a healthy child are as high as 80% when you compare to non-carrier couples. So that's why it becomes very important to find out the carrier status, even when the conceptus is normal. So chances of having subsequent miscarriage becomes higher if the parent is in carrier state. So that's why it is very important to find out the carrier state in the husband or wife. What about the PGD? Because there is a lot of talk about the PGD in these patients when you are having multiple recurrent pregnancy loss. But here you can see the PGD may not be very helpful in deciding the taking the decision, because this is a study, I think 2015, live birth rate in PGD group was 31%, when live birth rate in natural conception was 55.5%. So this is just opposite when you compare the PGD group and the normal patients who do not go for PGD. However, how PGD can help in recurrent pregnancy loss? The miscarriage rate in PGD group was lower when you compare to normal conception. So if a patient is having PGD, the chances of miscarriage rate will be lower than the normal conception. So live birth rate, there is no improvement. So if you are looking at the live birth rate, it may not be helpful, but to minimize the miscarriage rate, yes, PGD may be helpful. And here you can see the latest guidelines of 2017. All patients should receive genetic counseling. So genetic counseling is very, very important, and informed consent and limitation of evidence in improving live birth. So because the patient wants a live birth, so it may not be helpful in giving the live birth, but certainly counsel patients how much is the risk they can be offered PGT in their workup. Now, these are some of the green top recommendations. Cytogenetic analysis should be performed on product of conception. We have already discussed this. Parental peripheral blood karyotyping of both partners should be performed. When the POCs are having unbalanced structural chromosome, this also we have already discussed, so we can skip. Now, coming on to the role of pelvic ultrasound, and I think they are very clear. Current guidelines also, and 2011 guidelines also, a pelvic ultrasound to assess uterine anomalies is very, very important investigation in workup of recurrent pregnancy loss. And all suspected uterine anomalies may require further investigation to confirm the diagnosis using hysteroscopy, three-dimensional pelvic ultrasound, and maybe saline infusion sonography also comes here as the investigation in recurrent pregnancy loss. Coming on to the extended profile in the form of inherited thrombophilia. Now, there is a strong association between the second trimester pregnancy in inherited thrombophilia. So if patient is having second trimester abortion, I think these inherited thrombophilia profile becomes important. But this is the latest one, SRAE 2017. For women with RPL, we suggest not to screen for hereditary thrombophilia unless in the context of research, and in women with additional risk factor for thrombophilia. So when the patient is having either a high risk, then only conditionally you can offer these tests. Otherwise, they don't help you in the prognosis and treatment of hereditary thrombophilia. They are very weak evidence. Either they are unclear or there is no benefit. and this includes factor 5 Leiden mutation, prothrombin mutation, MTHFR mutation, protein C, protein S, and antithrombin. So again, this is a gray area. We have been doing this for all patients, but this is the recent guideline that it should not be done in all patients, and we have to select the patient where it can help. Now, cause of endometrial abnormality, again, we have to look on uterine cavity pathology, structural uterine anomalies, and other thing. So hysteroscopy here comes into the picture, that all patients who are having recurrent pregnancy loss or recurrent implantation failure, they need to undergo hysteroscopic evaluation to rule out any septal defect. That is what is the recommendation. Septal resection, partial or complete, should it be resected or not? Here you can see, because poor vascularity of the septum, disordered myometrial contraction, so this is supposed to be corrected. And it has been seen that in almost 37% of the patient, you can get a better result after the resection of the septum. And this is easier surgery, so you can just go inside and resect it. Now, there are a lot of literature and current recommendation, they are against interfering with the septum as well as polyp, submucosal fibroid. They say that there is no evidence that you are going to give benefit after septal resection or polyp. But as an infertility consultant, I strongly believe that this is one thing which we can offer to these patients, and it can certainly help in getting a live baby after the resection or removal of the polyp. And because this is a subject of debate, I will like to ask Madam Sharda Jain also her thought over these interventions. Uterocervical abnormalities, again, septum we have already discussed. The metroplasty, this is a gray area whether it is going to improve the outcome or not. Prophylactic cervical cerclage has been suggested but may not be very helpful. When you are having incompetent cervix, then certainly it is a intervention of choice in these patients. And what about the submucous intramural fibroid? Again, this has come into the question because ESRE 2017 guidelines say it has to be conditional. So conditional is a very big word, and it is left on to you whether you want to give benefit here or not. Uterine synechia, again, they are band-like structures, and here you can see this is Esselman grade 4. So in these patients, even if the implantation is occurring, it may not continue. So it is worthwhile to do the dissection whenever you are having uterine synechia. This is here, again, it is conditional, no definite benefit, but we usually see the benefit, so we keep on offering these procedures to our patient. And I am having a very large series on hysteroscopic adenodialysis, and it is published also in Fertility Sterility. So it is beneficial whenever you are offering these procedures to the to your patient. Certainly you can benefit them. Now you can see the cavity is so wide. Even in Esselman grade 4. So these are some of the patients where you can really help by offering hysteroscopic adenodialysis. Immunological factor, we have already discussed what should be done. But what about the elevated endometrial NK cell, dysregulation of interleukin? Because these are all factors which have been supposed to be acting in these patients. But when it comes to the treatment, there is no clear-cut benefit of giving any type of therapy. So whether we should look into it or not, that is area of research at present. It should not be offered in the clinical setting. It can be done in the research setting, but it should not be offered in clinical setting. Like uterine NK cells, they have been associated with RPL. This is very old study. But even after that, having a lot of research, there is no data to suggest whether giving the therapy for the, these conditions can help here. What about the infection? Again, there are very clear guidelines that these patients, they should not be offered any form of screening as far as the TORCH group is concerned. So, because what we are looking at, it is not fitting into the group. So, toxoplasmosis, cytomegalo, herpes, and listeria infection, they do not fulfill the criteria for screening. So, TORCH screening should be abandoned, basically. This is from both 2011 and 2017. Endocrine aberrations, again, there is not much here, but high BMI is supposed to be really, really a factor which needs to be looked into. High estrogen and high BMI and high androgen. So all these are important aberrations which needs to be looked into the management. Now, recommended management, designated clinic and personal, detailed reproductive history, and low-dose aspirin plus heparin to prevent further miscarriage. And this is coming from both 2011 and 2017 guidelines. What about the corticosteroid, intravenous immunoglobulin, and antilipid? They are not known to increase the take-home baby rate, so they should not be used routinely in recurrent pregnancy loss. That is the recommendation again from 2017 and 2011. This is one meta-analysis to assess the role of progesterone support, because we keep on giving progesterone support. Again, this is a gray area. Progesterone support for pregnancy showed that it did not reduce the sporadic miscarriage rate, but in recurrent miscarriage, progesterone treatment may offer a statistically significant decrease in the miscarriage rate. This is the older guideline, but in 2017, they have said there is insufficient evidence, so not recommended routinely, and it is conditional. Again, they have put the word conditional, that on the merit basis, you can use progesterone, but not routinely. Suppression of high LH before starting in polycystic ovary, again, there is not much evidence to support the routine use of suppression of LH. Routine use of metformin in these patients is not justified. Metformin has no been administered in pregnancy. Again, not recommended. What about the LIT therapy? Parental cell immunization, third-party donor leukocyte, trophoblast. Because I have been seeing that people have been using, but the guidelines are very clear in 2011 also and 2017 that unexplained recurrent miscarriage does not improve live birth by using LIT therapy or third-party donor leukocyte or even immunoglobulin. And this is the level A evidence. Heparin therapy during pregnancy may improve live birth rate of women with second trimester miscarriage associated with inherited thrombophilia. So there is the recommendation of using heparin in these patients. What about the TLC, that is tender loving care? There are three small non-randomized trials, but there are limitations of these trials. There was no testing for APS, control group are non-matched, and live birth rate claimed to increase by 50%. So again, we have to see, but because this is the area where you can really offer the tender loving care, so there is no harm. Actually, we are not doing any harm in these patients. So if they can get a live birth by your tender loving care, then they can be used. What about the women with unexplained recurrent miscarriage? They are having an excellent prognosis. That is a silver lining for future pregnancy outcome without any pharmacological intervention if offered supportive care alone in setting of a dedicated early pregnancy assessment unit. So I think this we need to develop. Even if you don't do any intervention, you just follow the pregnancy very closely, they can get a very good outcome. And this is my last slide. I think these are some of the ESRAE guidelines which are actually removed a lot of gray areas. Like genetic analysis of pregnancy tissue is not routinely recommended, but it could be performed for explanatory purpose. So it is again conditional. Parental karyotyping is not routinely recommended in couples with RPL. It could be carried out only after individual assessment of risk. So it is again conditional. For women with recurrent pregnancy loss, we suggest not to screen for hereditary thrombophilia unless in the context of research, or in women with additional risk factor for thrombophilia. This I have already highlighted. What about the sperm DNA fragmentation? Assessing sperm DNA fragmentation in couples with RPL can be considered for explanatory purpose. However, it is there is a indirect evidence, so it becomes a conditional investigation only. It may help, it may not help. So it should not be done routinely. Then there are a lot of other recommendations like measurement of anti-HIV antibodies, cytokinin testing, cytokinin polymorphism, anti-nuclear antibody. They should not be considered routinely. And if you are doing them, then it is only conditional. And here cytokine testing actually should not be used in clinical practice. It is a strong recommendation. There is insufficient evidence to recommend natural killer cell testing of either peripheral blood or endometrial tissue in recurrent pregnancy loss. Very strong recommendation. Testing of anti-HLA antibodies, again, not recommended. Very strong recommendation. So with this, I think I have given lot of things to for thought, and I have highlighted a lot of gray areas in my talk. Which needs to be taken care when we are dealing with recurrent pregnancy loss. Thank you very much for your patient hearing, and we are open now for discussion. Thank you.
Review of recurrent miscarriage, and this is a problem which every gynecologist is very quietly and listening, that you know something can be picked up from your talk. I think, you know, majority of the things you have made it crystal clear. I will chip in few of the areas which you asked for me. As far as the polyps are concerned, I feel that if there is a significant polyp, we get it removed, definitely.
Yeah.
And it is said to be that it will improve. As far as the septum is concerned, if the septum is too small, then we leave it alone. But if the septum is significant size, again, we see to it, it is done. Very, very clearly have said that EPLA investigations, the routine ones are 3 investigations, you get it done. The rest has been crystal clear from the lots of many things that, you know, though you don't need to investigate them because they are very expensive and should not be done routinely in such patients. Now, coming to the parental karyotyping, I have one word to say. At any time when we find that the karyotyping of the conceptors is abnormal, we are getting it done. Otherwise, if the conceptors karyotyping is normal, then we are not getting it done, because it is a very small, less than 5% of people who have this kind of things. Now, as far as the treatment part is concerned, we are clear that in case if we don't find anything, I use it HCG. And I use progestogens. And in progestogens, till now, we have been using a vaginal support of the progestogens. But now my leverage is going on to Duphaston for this purpose, because now the various studies have come out. I feel, you know, as far as tuberculosis is concerned, I come from a country which is called India. And India, 50% people have tuberculosis. And I find, you know, whenever we get this particular investigation done, which is an unknown area, you have said, we find good 1 in 3 people have underlying tuberculosis. And if you treat these patients, you find that these patients just sail through during the pregnancy with tender love and care, and as well as for support, which we give. Dr. Kuldeep has very clearly highlighted, these patients must visit you frequently. They must be told in the beginning itself that they will require a few more ultrasounds just to reassure them that everything is all right. I think, you know, the recurrent miscarriage is not all that a big problem. I'm very strongly believe that tuberculosis is one investigation which need to be done in case of recurrent pregnancy loss. I'm not talking in the Western world, I'm talking in India. And so I tell my own experience what it's all about. So now we are open to suggestions, comments.
And that's why actually I think hysteroscopy becomes, because in when I was reading the last SRA guidelines, and even I remember I was part of the recommendation committee of IFFS, and that time also I suggested that hysteroscopy should be used more and more in these patients. But everybody said, no, why hysteroscopy? But as far as Indian practice is concerned, I think we need to have our own guidelines where we feel, whatever we feel and what is helping our patients, we should try to include. Problem is, we are always following the Western guidelines, and that they are not always applicable to our patients. So that is my feeling. What do you say regarding that?
So let me be very frank with you. I have got nearly 45 plus years experience. I don't follow Western guidelines, but I feel what is useless is useless. Like you talked in therapy, corticosteroid, immunoglobulins, intralipid. They have no sense. But progesterone support, yes, and HCG, yes. I think I give. I feel, you know, it.
I also agree on that. And I think because the whatever guidelines say, it is our practice also which teaches us a lot. And we should include our experience whenever we are teaching, we are treating these patients. So that is, I think, a take-home message from your comments also and from my talk also.
Because Kuldeep, I think high time has come, you know, we make a presentations and we talk about what is done in UK, what is done here, what is that. What is UK? It's less than UP. So yes. What I'm trying to say, they are great teachers, but I think, you know, it's not that we have nuts here. We also have something, and we must speak of our own experience. If you speak from your own experience, this is what I have a Ramban with this particular patient. I think I fully agree with you. If nothing is there and you find it's an unexplained recurrent miscarriage, reassure her that if she comes frequently and she abides whatever you have said, she will take the baby home in 70% of patients.
Yes, yes, yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kuldeep. Thank you, ma'am. Vikrant, can you please start with the panel discussion? May we have the slides?
Definitely.
And there are a lot many questions in the chat box, but I am not taking them up because
yes, while we take
the panel discussion,